Well, good morning. Let's try that again. Good morning. Welcome to Broadmoor United Methodist Church. My name is Donnie Wilkinson. I'm one of the pastors here. We're so grateful that you are with us in worship this morning. We want to say a special word of welcome to those who are worshiping with us online as well. A couple of real quick announcements, some things that you need to be aware of and that I hope that you will participate in. The next community garage sale drop-off is going to be March 2nd from 9 a.m. to noon. The drop-off is over by the casual worship center. You'll see the big shipping container there, and that's right where you will take your items and drop them off. Items that are accepted and not accepted are listed on your bulletin, and if you have questions, you can contact members of the garage sale team, and they will get you squared away with that. Next announcement. Many of you are aware that East Baton Rouge is doing a major road improvement program. One of the roads that is on the schedule to have a major overhaul and upgrade is Sharp Road right out here. And yes, thank you, absolutely. That we are hosting a community forum event this Thursday, February 29th, from 5:30 to 7 p.m. It's not a set program. It's a drop-in sort of program. They're going to have displays of the of every section of Sharp Road from Old Hammond Highway all the way to Florida Boulevard to show you how that is going to lay out. And in particular, I hope that you will go and pay attention to the section that is right here at the corner of Sharp and Molly Lee. It's going to impact us for a period of time while they are doing the improvements. I believe it's going to be a tremendous improvement both to the flow and the community feel there, but it will impact us in part because somewhere along the line we put our electronic sign and some parking on property that isn't technically ours. And so, you know, you go into a church and go, wow, how did that happen? Anyway, it's one of those things. We have some parking on there, so it will impact what we think is our campus, but technically is not our campus there. So I hope that you'll come and be a part of that so that you can see it, and then I hope that you will support the proposal as it moves its way forward. One last announcement. We love having new people come to be a part of Broadmoor. We want to help you find a way to get plugged in. Our next New to Broadmoor luncheon is going to be Sunday, March 10th, immediately following the 11 o'clock service. That'll be over in the Adult Education Building, room 101. If you are been to Broadmoor for a little while, if you're just visiting, you want to find out more, or even if you've been coming for a while but you want to take a next step and get more plugged in, this is a great opportunity for you to come and be a part of that. More information about how you can get registered for that will be coming in the next few weeks. At this time, I want to invite Grace Olton to step up to the pulpit and share with you one more brief announcement about an important ministry of our church.
Good morning. I'd like to invite you all to purchase a ticket for our United Women in Faith March Mission Madness, which is March 16th, Saturday the 16th. It'll be in the Casual Worship Center. We'll have refreshments, bake sale, book sale, used book sale, great bargains, the book sale and the bakery, jewelry sale, another good bargain, and J. Jill style show. And they'll come out and model. Many of our women, well, 10 of them, are modeling. Some of us, they don't have things short enough for me to wear. Anyway, but we are really hoping you'll show up. It's our only money-making event of the year. So thank you. I'll be available in the foyer of AEB this morning. And then next week, we'll have someone in the Connection Cafe and both places. Thank you.
Thank you, Grace. At this time, let's allow our pre-service music to help prepare our hearts for worship.
Well, we hope that inspires you to sing the text of that great hymn tune. Let's stand as you are able, and we'll do just that together.
Unity and love for one another, let us affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed, followed by the ancient hymn of praise, the Gloria Patri. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we come into our time of prayer, I invite you to turn your palms up in your lap, to close your eyes, take a few easy, gentle breaths. And simply relax into the arms of God's love, knowing that you are safe, that you are beloved. Let us lift our hearts and minds to God. I invite you to begin this time of prayer with gratitude. Give thanks to God for three specific blessings that you are conscious of and grateful for this day. invite you now to pray for three people that you know that you believe need an extra dose of God's grace and goodness in their lives. Lift their names to God, asking God to bless them, to fill them with hope and love and strength and joy. I invite you to allow the Holy Spirit to help you review the past 24 hours and to ask for forgiveness for specific mistakes or sins, places where you missed the mark, and ask for the strength to forgive others. I invite you to pray for one person that you have a hard time getting along with. Ask God to give them insight into the nature of their problems and to give you the strength to let God's love flow through you to them. I invite you to ask God to give you sensitivity to the needs of one person that you can show God's love to in word or deed today. I invite you to ask God for help with your problem. Places of pain and sorrow and struggle in your life. Ask for healing. Ask for help. Ask for hope. I invite you to ask God for help in achieving your goals. Ask God to show you the next faithful step. Give you the courage to take it. I invite you now to ask God this question and to listen with all that you have for God's reply. Lord, what do you want to do through me? God, we thank you. We thank you for these moments of quiet rest in the midst of our chaotic and busy lives. We thank you for being a God who's always ready to hear the cries of our hearts. Receive now our prayers, for we offer them to you in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In just a few moments, we will continue with our worship through the giving of our tithes, gifts, and offerings. I'll give you a moment to prepare for that. And as you do, I'd like to invite you to find the registration of attendance pads. They're located on the inside portion of the pews. If you would, make sure that everybody seated on your pew has the opportunity to do that. And make sure they make their way all the way to the outside edges. That helps our ushers pick them up afterwards. If you're visiting with Broadmoor, particularly if it's your first time, we're so honored that you would come and join us in worship, that we would love to make a donation in your name to one of the ministries that we support. If you're a guest, a first-time guest, or the first time prepared to share contact information with us, if you'll put your name and your cell phone number down on the guest portion of the pad there, we'll reach out to you this week and let you know how you can choose which ministry that you would like this donation to go to be made in your name towards. This time I'd like to invite our ushers, if they will, to come forward as we prepare to honor God through the giving of our tithes, gifts, and offerings. Let us pray together. Our gracious and loving God, we thank you. We thank you for the way that you use our gifts to help transform the world into a more just and loving and healthy and whole place. Receive now these, our tithes, gifts, and offerings. Bless and multiply them, for we give them in the name of Jesus. And together the people of God said, Amen. Been thinking about what we're striving to achieve as a church. If I had to boil it down to just one sentence, it would be more and more people becoming more and more like Jesus. More and more people becoming more and more like Jesus. That's really the theme that we are exploring. What does it mean for people today in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, in the year of our Lord 2024, with all of the chaos, with all of the turmoil, with all of the uncertainty? What does it mean for us to be people whose lives don't pay lip service to Jesus, but our lives actually look like Jesus' life? And it goes back to that line from from 1 John that we have been reflecting on now for several months. Those who say, I abide in him, those who say, I'm a Jesus person, must walk as he walked. How do we learn to order our lives in such a way that we are becoming more and more like Jesus? To help us do that, we are this year reading through one chapter a day of the letters of the New Testament. We read the Gospels last fall. Now we're working our way through the letters. If you don't have one of the reading plans, I've got one. Yep, here's one right here. All right. See me after. Nope, that's the last one. There's in the back there. Just trust me. We've got plenty, okay? But we're in the middle of what many people consider the most pivotal, central, important of all of the New Testament letters, Paul's letter to the Romans. As we shared last week, we would not be gathered at Broadmoor United Methodist Church if it was not for this letter that Paul wrote to the Christian communities in Rome back in the first century, because it was when John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, went to a little small group meeting that they were reading a part of something that Martin Luther wrote about Romans, that he had an encounter with God that left him forever changed. This is how he describes it. In the evening, I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street, where one was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans. About a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation. And an assurance was given me that Christ had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. Now, the most famous part of that line, of that little journal entry, is where he talks about his heart strangely warmed. But I want to draw your attention to the part that came right before that, describing the change which God works in the heart through faith. That part is drawn from the chapters of Romans that we are going to look at today. We're going to look at chapters 5 and 6 in particular, which is the part where it describes how God transforms us from one way of life into another way of life, as we learn to have faith, to trust in Christ. As I shared with you last week, the big idea of Romans is this: people who have faith, people who trust, people who bet their lives on the truth of Jesus, those who have faith in Jesus are transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit into a new humanity who are the fulfillment of all of God's promises, become a new type of human being, no longer living the way that everybody else does, no longer beholden to the power of sin and death and corruption and just general nastiness that human beings have a proclivity towards treating each other. We can agree on that, right? Human beings, we can be some pretty nasty creatures, right? Paul's argument here in the chapters we're looking at is that as we come to trust in Jesus, that old way of life dies and a new way of life is born. How Paul has structured the book of Romans is kind of divided into four parts. The first four is where he's describing the tragic condition that human beings are. We're made in the image and likeness of God. We're made to be God's stewards of this beautiful earth. We're made to live in right relationship with God and with our neighbors. But we can't stop getting in our own way. We keep acting in ways that rupture our relationship with God and rupture our relationship with others and rupture our relationship with ourselves, so that we don't even feel at home in our own skin. The first part of Romans, Paul is describing how this tragic situation that we are in, but how it proves the goodness of God. The second part, the part we're going to look at today, Paul talks about how the gospel creates a new humanity. The story of Jesus' life and death and resurrection and now ruling over all of creation rescues people out of this tragedy, out of the muck and mire of our lives, and puts us on a firm foundation so that we can at last, at long last, live out our vocation as human beings. People made in the image and likeness of God to rule and reign and steward God's creation and to support and encourage one another and live in right relationship with all beings. Chapters 9 and 11, Paul takes a moment to say how this action, this good news, is the fulfillment of all the promises that God had made to Abraham and to the people of Israel in years before. And then the final part, he's writing to a community that is it's danger of pulling apart because of their divisions. He talks about how this gospel actually unifies people across all sorts of boundaries, racial boundaries, gender boundaries, class boundaries, cultural boundaries, language boundaries. The gospel has the power to unite people. And that's what we're going to be looking at next week. You know as well as I do, we live in a day and an age in which we feel like we're being pulled apart at the seams, and I believe the only hope that we have is by finding that deeper unity that transcends and is greater than all of our surface differences. We'll talk about that next week. We really want to focus in on what is this promise of becoming a new humanity, transformed and empowered by the Holy Spirit. And this is where Paul begins in chapter 5. He begins, we're going to pick up with verse 6, where Paul describes once again the problem and then God's solution. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's the gospel. That's the good news. Here's the truth. You and I, we're a hot mess. And God loves us. You and I do things that hurt other people, and God loves us. You and I act in ways that harm ourselves, and God loves us. Paul says, God proves his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Now, I need to take just a moment. You know, we live in a day and age where some of the old language, the true language, the clear language, has gotten so muddled, and we've probably all seen or heard people throw around words, sinner this and sinner that, and it's an effort to guilt and shame people. But we need to take just a moment and unpack what it means to be a sinner. That word in both the Old and the New Testament simply means to miss the mark. Let me ask you this. over the past 7 days, has there been anything that you did that you know you should not have done, or anything that you did not do that you know you should have done? Yes or no? Yeah. Okay. You missed the mark. You missed the mark. And sometimes churches miss the mark by trying to make people feel shame. And there's a big difference between guilt and shame. All right. I love how Brené Brown, the eminent sociologist and author and just all-around awesome person, describes it. In reality, she says that guilt is good, because guilt is a psychological discomfort that we feel when we hold something that we've done or failed to do up against our values. That feeling that you got, you said, "Oh man, I should have taken the trash out." We'll put the stakes really low right now, okay? I should have called them. I know they're going through a tough time. I should have called them. That psychological discomfort that we feel, that's guilt. You're holding yourself up against a set of values that you want to live by. And whenever there's a gap, you feel a discomfort, and that discomfort lets you know that you need to take action to close the gap. Okay, you understand what I'm talking about there? Guilt is good. Shame, however, is bad. Shame is the intensely painful feeling or experience of believing that we are flawed and therefore unworthy of love and belonging. Something we've experienced, done, or failed to do makes us unworthy of connection. Guilt is, I did something wrong. I did something bad. Shame is, I am bad. You understand the difference between the two? Now, look back at that line here when Paul says, this is the gospel, verse 8. God proves his what? He proves his what? His love for us, that while we were still missing the mark, Christ died for us. When we miss the mark, we may feel guilt, but we ought to never feel shame, because Paul says here that there is nothing that you have ever done that makes you unlovable. There is nothing you have ever done that makes you unworthy of connection and belonging with God. Yes, you messed up. Yes, I messed up. Yes, every human being on the face of the earth has missed the mark. We're all sinners. The good news is that God has shown his love to us by sending Christ to die for us while we're still sinners. And another one of Paul's letters, ones we looked at a couple of weeks ago, 2 Corinthians 7:10, he put it this way: godly grief produces repentance that leads to salvation and brings us no regret, but worldly grief produces death. You could substitute guilt and shame for those things. Godly guilt, when you tell a lie, when you steal, when you cheat on your spouse, when you act in some way that violates the Big Ten Commandments, some way that doesn't honor and respect it, I hope you feel guilt. That's the God's Spirit pinging you to say, hey, let's course correct here. And that leads to repentance, which is just turning around, and that puts us on the road to salvation, to living in right relationship with God and others. It brings no regret, but worldly grief, shame, brings death. If you struggle with shame, if you feel that you are unworthy of love and connection, I just want to tell you that that belief is a lie from the pit of hell. The whole Bible story points to this fact that you are loved more than you will ever know. And the way that God has shown that is through Christ freely giving himself for you. You are worthy of love and connection and belonging. And you need to turn from that lie and reorient your life around the truth of God's love for you. Paul says that God proves his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Faith is trusting that that is true, allowing that statement to become the bedrock foundation upon which you build your life. Continues on with verse 9, much more surely, therefore, since we have now been justified by his blood. Justified simply means made right. You justify the margins on a document. That means all the mark, all the letters line up on the edges just right in a straight line. You're made right with God. We're justified by Christ's blood. We'll be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were still enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin, missing the mark, came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, and so death was spread to all because all have sinned. For sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who did not sin in the likeness of Adam, who's a pattern of the one to come. Now, I realize that's a pretty complex sentence there, so let me make it plain for you. Y'all know who Adam is, right? Genesis 3, did Adam trust God's direction and do what God say, or did he go off on his own way? Went off on his own way. Paul uses the story of Adam and Eve in Genesis 3 as an archetype and says there are basically two ways of living. You either follow the way of Adam, which we all do, or we can follow the way of Christ. And what he does is he compares and contrasts Adam with Christ. And there are two sorts of ways that we can live. The way of Adam, following our own desires, our own predilections, wanting to go our own way, wanting to be in our own God, or we follow the way of Christ. The free gift, he says, the free gift, and that gift that he described up in verse 8, Christ's death on the cross for us, it's not like the trespass. For many died through Adam's trespass, much more surely have the grace and the gift of the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for the many. Yes, many people missed the mark and have followed the way of Adam, but now that Christ has come, we are set free to no longer follow the way of death, but now we can follow the way that leads to life. He goes on in verse 18, therefore, just as the one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. Just as through the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so through the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. He's talking about comparing, contrasting the way of Adam, which is the way of fallen humanity, the way of death and corruption. If you go to that next slide for me. The way of Adam with the way of Christ. And the good news is that now we are set free to no longer have to follow in the footsteps of Adam. Now we can follow in the footsteps of Christ. We can walk as Jesus walked and be part of God's new creation here and now. And that just raises a basic question. Well, a question that I've been sitting with this week, and I just share it with you, and I invite you to reflect on it. Maybe take a few moments this afternoon and really Think it through. In what ways does your life currently reflect the way of Adam? I'm not talking about running around naked, not wearing any clothes. Although that, I guess that if you were naked, N-E-K-K-I-D, that might be the way of Adam. But that wanting to follow your own, not live by within the boundaries that God has set. Living a way of generosity and peace and shalom and right relationship. In what ways does your life reflect the way of Adam? And when you identify those ways, the choice is, will I keep going the way that leads to death? Or am I going to go the way that leads to life? Now, there was a question that the people in Rome were struggling with. It's a question that people struggle with today, a question that I sometimes catch myself falling into. Well, I guess God's just going to have to forgive me. I'm going to do this thing. I know it's wrong, but God's just going to have to forgive me. Anybody ever said something like that? Yeah, okay. So Paul comes in. What then are we to say? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may increase? God's a forgiving God, so I'm just going to sin more so that God can forgive me more. It's kind of a faulty circular logic there. He goes, by no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we might also have newness of life. What then are we to say? Should we continue in sin? Should we continue in sin? And Paul uses a little Greek word. It's one of my favorite Greek words. I remember the day that Clifton Black, who is the professor of New Testament at Perkins School of Theology, taught us. The Greek word there is meganoito. Mega meaning superabundance, and noito is no. And so literally, if you want to get the feel of it, should we continue to sin so that grace may abound? Not just no, hell no. Hell no. We don't go on living this way because we have died to sin. And that's, we have followed the pattern of Christ. And you go to this next slide, you can see Paul describes how just as Christ died and was buried and then raised to new life, in your baptism, you followed that same pattern. You died, you were buried, and you were raised to new life. Because if we've been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, so that we may no longer be enslaved to sin. Now, that's one of the most audacious claims that Paul makes anywhere. Those habitual sins that you struggle with, those aren't something that you are going to have to struggle with your whole rest of your life. The promise is that the Spirit can set you free. Set you completely free from sin so that you no longer are struggling in that way. Paul goes on and says, whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we died with Christ, we believe we will also live with him. For we know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death that he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you may obey their desires. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your body to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no more dominion over you, since you're no longer under law, but under grace. Paul goes on through the end of chapter 5 and through the end of chapter 6, building up this line of thinking, saying that we need to set free, we need to be make a choice. Are we going to keep following the way of Adam, or are we going to enter into the way that leads to life? And he culminates there at the end of Romans 6:23 with these words, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." If you go down to slide 30 for me. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. It may sound harsh, but actually Paul is being very kind. Paul is just making it clear for us. Brene Brown, to circle back to her once again, she has a phrase that I love. Clear is kind, unclear is unkind. Paul is doing everything he can just to make it as clear as possible for us. We have a choice. We're going down the road and they come to a fork in the road. We can either choose the fork that leads to life or the fork that leads to death. One is the way of Christ, the other is the way of Adam. Life, death. Christ, Adam. Which will you choose? Gracious God, give us wisdom and open our eyes so that we might truly see the choice we have ahead of us. Help us to respond to this gift that you have given us in Christ so that we might live. Amen.
I invite you now to stand as able as we sing this closing hymn together.
Hutchinson, they've been a part of the congregation now for several months and officially becoming members today, and they're my neighbors. They live, three doors down? So we're welcome. We're so glad that you're a part of us. Joe's jumped in, has been a part of Red Stick Together, and they've come into Holy Chow and Women Making a Difference and all of those things, and so we're so thrilled that you're taking this step today. We simply ask you the questions that we ask every person when they come forward. Do you believe in your heart and confess with your lips that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father? And will you be members of this church and live out your faith in Christ through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Will you do this? Well, then we welcome you officially into membership of Broadmoor United Methodist Church. So give our new brothers and sisters a hand. I'm going to invite them to join with me, stand with me in the back, and as you're heading out this morning, greet them officially. Let's stand now and receive now our benediction. Let's join together in our closing blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
My friends, may you go in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. My friends, may you go in grace and in the knowledge.